Hello and welcome to worship with Oakhurst United Methodist Church today. I'm glad that you're joining us. I'm Pastor Nathan. I'm the co-pastor here along with Pastor Tim, who you'll be hearing from in today's message. We have a few announcements we want to share before we get started. We have a prayer time Monday through Saturday that Pastor Tim leads. You can find that on Facebook Live on our Facebook page, Oakhurst UMC. You can also find us on YouTube, Oakhurst UMC, there as well. Look for the tree logo. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, Stephanie Fergenbaum shares a Just for Kids moment, and that's a great time to explore an object lesson and to see what it means for our life of faith. Now, there's also a good catalog of bite-sized Bible studies on there. We've been going through the Gospel of Matthew, and that study will resume with new content in a few weeks. We have other activities going on in the life of the church throughout this time. You can find all of them on YouTube and Facebook if you're looking for some spiritual content. We're also available if you need any prayer or just to talk with another person here at the church, or if you want some guidance during this time of COVID and social and physical distancing. We're here for you, and we're glad you're here with us in this worship service. We hope that you'll be blessed by it this morning.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so happy to be able to greet you this morning from Kenya, say hi to you all, and to join in a call to worship with you. Won't you pray with me now, please? Almighty God, we thank you that we can come boldly into your presence through the Holy Spirit, and that we are righteous in your sight through your Son, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that as we abide in Christ, we also abide in your favor. We come before you this morning, Lord, many of us struggling with our current situation in the chaos of our world right now. Sometimes it feels like time is going fast, even as our lives have become so slow. Our goals, our calling to you, seem almost to be on hold, and yet we know that your purpose and focus for us is on our journey, to live a life dependent on you and your power now, to stay focused through the power of the Holy Spirit on you, Lord Jesus, on your light, on your faithfulness and your goodness. Our moment-by-moment obedience and our ordinary, everyday, slow lives is what you desire. And as we surrender to you, we find that we are able to stay calm, faithful, and unconfused while in the middle of the turmoil of this life. We lift up our hands, our hearts, to worship you this morning, Lord. Let us praise you in singing and dancing. Let us never stop thanking you and praising you for our salvation, for your mercy and your love given new to us every morning. We know that our worship is pleasing to you, Father, and gives you great joy, and that your joy is passed back to us by the Holy Spirit. It is this wonderful joy that gives us the strength to walk in your ways every day, to have no fear, but to trust in your mighty power and sovereignty. Thank you, Father. We love you, we praise you, and we worship your holy name. Amen.
Ooh,
Let's join together for our pastoral prayer now. Almighty God, we thank you so much for gathering us together in worship today. Lord, we pour out our hearts before you. We open up our minds before you that we might be transformed by the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. We ask during this time of worship as we prepare to hear your word spoken to us, that we would be still, that we would know and acknowledge your presence and feel you with us, that we would be open to your leading. Lord, it hasn't always been easy during this time, and we might be going through a difficult time in our life with our health, with our finances, or with our faith today. But Lord, we know that you are with us in the midst of these struggles. And so we hand over all of the good and all of the bad in our lives to you. Take from us now our burdens as we pick up your easy yoke and follow after you. We pray all of this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Well, good morning again, everyone. In my sermon the last time I preached, I spoke about three goals of having a relationship with God. The first one being to grow in our knowledge and experience of God continually. The second one, to use our continuing knowledge and experience of God to help us to become transformed, to be more in the image of Jesus Christ. And then the third goal, to use that relationship that we have with God to help us to serve others in God's name. So today, I'm going to talk about the second one of those goals, which is being transformed. And I'm going to talk about Christian meditation as a way to help us to become transformed in our minds, as Paul talked about. So before I get there, I want to start with a guy who is very good at meditating, a Buddhist guy who was in New York City, and he went up to a hot dog vendor and he said to the guy, "I'm a Buddhist," and he said, "I want you to give me a Zen hot dog." The hot dog vendor said, "What is that?" He said, "Make me one with everything." So the hot dog vendor made him one with everything. He handed it to him. The Buddhist guy gave him a $20 bill. The hot dog vendor took the $20 bill, he stuck it in the cash drawer, closed the drawer. The Buddha said, "Where's my change?" The hot dog vendor said, "Buddha said, change must come from within." Let's join together for a word of prayer. Lord God, I give thanks and praise to you for the awesome privilege and responsibility of sharing your word with your congregation this morning. I pray, Lord, that all that I say and all that we hear would be acceptable in your sight, for you are our creator, our redeemer, and our sustainer. Thank you, Lord. Amen. So my sermon today is entitled, "Be Still and Know That I Am God." And you probably know that that comes from the Bible. It comes from actually Psalm 46. "Be still and know that I am God." That is God speaking to us. And that passage is somewhat ironic in a way, because so many of us, myself included, spend an awful lot of our time actively trying to get to know God better through reading the Bible, through daily prayer, through attending worship, taking communion, Christian service to others, listening to lectures and sermons, a lot of different things. And then this passage comes along, "Be still and know that I am God." And it seems to sort of put a monkey wrench into all of that, because it sounds like it's saying, you know, all you have to do if you want to know God is just sit and do nothing. But the reality is that being still is actually not as simple as it sounds. Have you ever tried to just quiet your mind, to go somewhere and sit and just have not a single thought, just empty your mind of all thoughts? If you've ever tried that, as I have, you know that it can be pretty difficult. What we find, most people find, is that we have a stream of consciousness. We have thoughts that keep popping into our head continually, and it can be very difficult to quiet our mind. In fact, quieting your mind is actually a skill, an art form that is something that takes practice. And that's what Christian meditation is really all about. One holy man described the process of learning how to quiet our thoughts and listen for God this way. Here's what he said. "In meditation, at first, your mind is like a stream flowing over lots of rocks. It rapidly goes up and down, back and forth. With time, with practice, it becomes more like a slow-flowing, gentle river. And eventually, it empties into the ocean, which is where we experience unity with God." I like that imagery, the image of, you know, the thoughts, the stream of consciousness kind of being like that, going through the rapids and all those rocks. And that's the reality that most people find, that most people never get to quiet their mind. They get stuck in the rapids. They get stuck in that place where the thoughts are going up and down and side to side and never seem to stop. But listening to God takes stillness inside us. If we really want to listen to God, we need to be quiet. If we're not really listening to God, if we've got those thoughts coming in from side to side and up and down, what we experience is kind of like listening to somebody who's talking to us at a rock concert. I don't know if you've ever been to a rock concert, but it's so loud. And if somebody is standing right here, literally right here, they have to scream in your ear before you can hear them. And even then, sometimes it's hard to hear. Well, we don't want that to be our relationship with God. God screaming at us and barely even then being able to be heard. Now, one reason why it's good for us to be able to quiet our mind is that not only does it help us to listen to God, but it also helps us to talk to God. Relationship is not just about talking. It's about talking and listening, interacting. And our relationship with God has got to be the same way. There's an old saying, you've probably heard this one, God gave us two ears and only one mouth, so we should listen twice as much as we talk. Well, our relationship with God is like that. Our prayer time should always include a time to listen for God. We pray to God, but we need to listen. We don't always find that God is speaking back to us, but if we're not listening, He certainly is going to have a much harder time of getting through to us. So do you remember the story of Elijah in the Bible and how God spoke to Elijah? Well, Elijah is running away from the prophets of Baal, and he's hiding in a cave. And first, God sends an earthquake, and then a fire, and then a roaring wind. And then God speaks to Elijah in a small, still voice. And what we find so often is that God speaks to us in a small, still voice. If it serves God's purpose and God needs to get a point across, God will shout, God will get our attention. But generally, God's communications seem to be soft and quiet and gentle. Can you imagine having a relationship in which your entire relationship is based on communication where you just shout at each other? Well, I don't think we would want that with any kind of relationship that we have, and we certainly shouldn't want that with God either. We need to have that time where we are learning how to be quiet and listening for God. So the second goal of relationship with God is about being transformed and the transforming of your mind. Paul wrote, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and perfect and acceptable." Now, the transformation of your mind that Paul is talking about is in part to be still in your mind, to be able to listen to God so that you're able to discern what God's will is. Now, Paul also said, "Let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus Christ." Now, he didn't mean, again, that we should somehow swap brains with Jesus. What he meant is that same approach of being able to hear God when God speaks. In his letter to the Romans, Paul said this, "To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace." For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So if we want to be pleasing to God, we need to set our mind on the things of the Spirit. Now, excuse me, that's another place where Christian meditation can help us. When we are able to be quiet, be still in our mind, then we're also able not just to discern the will of God, but also to then focus our mind on the Holy Spirit. And that is pleasing to God when we do that. Now, being able to still your mind is also useful, not just spiritually, but it's useful in our daily life as well. Rudyard Kipling said, "If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, yours is the earth and everything in it." Well, Christian meditation, when we get good at it, when we are able to still our mind, it also helps us to be calm in the midst of any situation. It teaches us how to do that, and that's a great thing. Now, the practice of learning how to quiet your mind is not boring, and it's not depressing. In fact, it can be quite amusing when you're trying and you're paying attention to what the interesting random thoughts are that seem to run through your mind. But when we are successful in quieting our minds, it opens us up to the peace that passes all understanding. I was thinking about Psalm 24. "Open up, O ancient gates. Open up, O ancient doors. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in." Ironically, we open up by shutting down. We open up our mind to God by shutting down our thoughts. Jonathan Edwards was a famous American preacher and a revivalist. Lived in the 1780s. He was very influential in the Great Awakening movement in the United States. He also was very experienced in Christian meditation, and here's what he wrote about his experience in Christian meditation. "As I looked up on the sky and the clouds, there came to my mind a sweet sense of the glorious majesty and the grace of God that I know not how to express. The appearance of everything was altered. There seemed to be, as it were, a calm, a sweet cast or appearance of divine glory in almost everything. God's excellency, his wisdom, his purity, and love seemed to appear in everything, in the sun, in the clouds, in the blue sky, in the grass, the flowers, trees, in the water, and all nature." So there it is. When we reach the high point of Christian meditation, when that river, the gentle flowing river, opens up into the ocean and we get that unity with God, we get to experience the calmness, the sweetness, the sense of power and grace of God. And that all sounds really terrific. So for all these reasons, to help us hear God clearly, to improve our relationship with God, to get the ability to be calm in the midst of the storm, and to experience the sweetness of the grace and the peace, to be able to see God in the things and the people around us, all these reasons are good reasons why we should practice Christian meditation. Now, when I say meditation, you may picture in your mind a group of monks in their saffron robes with shaved heads sitting in the lotus position saying, "Om, Om." Well, that's not what I'm talking about. There are a lot of different ways to practice Christian meditation. And the key thing for us is to set our mind on God and to quiet our mind to everything else. St. John of the Cross, a Roman Catholic priest and saint who died in 1591, was also an expert in Christian meditation, and he wrote this. This is a how-to. "Put from your mind everything you have been doing or plan to do. Reject all thoughts, be they good or evil. Do not pray with words, unless you are really drawn to this. See that nothing remains in your conscious mind save a naked intent of stretching out toward God." So the goal of quieting our minds means to stop the busyness of thoughts and ultimately to try to not be aware of anything else but God. So I'm going to talk about five different types of Christian meditation that I've tried and that I've used. And my hope is that one of these will appeal to you enough that you'll try it, because I know you'll be blessed by it if you do. Now, none of these five things that I'm going to lift up are better than any particular other one. You just listen to it and see if any of them appeal to you, and whichever one seems best to you, try that. Now, the first and the most common mentioned in Scripture is meditating on Scripture. King David is believed to have written these words there from Psalm number 1. He said this, "Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers, but their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night." The Apostle Paul said something similar. "Whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things." In this type of meditation on Scripture, we take a key phrase or a key idea from Scripture, and we just let that and only that run in our mind. For example, we would say something, we would take something like, "The steadfast love of the Lord lasts forever." That's a little bit long. We could say, "God is a God of truth." Or we could say, "The justice of God." There are many different concepts that you could grab a hold of, commandments of God. And I find that when I take one of these things and just meditate on it, allow it to just be in my mind to the exclusion of everything else, and just let all the other thoughts go, just repeat it and see what comes to me. What I find is that it seems to resonate in my spirit, in my soul. It seems to touch me at a deeper place than it would otherwise. And I find that to be a very effective way to meditate, to just take a scripture passage or an idea from the scripture and just let that be the only thought in my head. We do that, the period of time for that is about an hour, maybe 45 minutes to an hour. A second form of Christian meditation is the contemplation of a visual subject. The thing that I particularly like to use is a picture of Jesus Christ. I have lots of different paintings of Christ in my office. And I pick a picture of Christ. Some people like to use a candle. Some people even stare at a blank wall. The whole point of that is just to remove all thoughts from your mind and just try to experience the calm center inside yourself where the Holy Spirit comes to rest inside us. Now, a third form of Christian meditation may surprise you, and that is an active form, Tai Chi or dance or even running. If you are an active person like I am, sometimes sitting still for an hour might be difficult for you, or this just might be something you'd like to do. King David danced before the Lord as a way to worship. You may have heard the expression, "Dance like no one is watching you." Well, if you're going to do this exercise, I recommend you do it where no one can be watching you so you don't feel self-conscious and you're not thinking about what somebody else is thinking about you. The whole idea of this thing is to, through motion, let go of thoughts. Through motion, just flow with the feeling and the emotion of worship and praise while trying to be aware of the Holy Spirit moving inside you. One of the most widely used types of Christian meditation is to use a mantra or a single word such as Spirit or Jesus or Father, and just repeating it and only that one word again and again for about 20 minutes to half an hour. And the goal is, again, to, as you're repeating that one word, to let go of all other thoughts and just let that presence of the Spirit be in you. Let go of all other thoughts and just be at that calm center where the Holy Spirit gets to rest inside you. And the last form of meditation that I want to talk about is the breathing meditation. Everybody breathes, so everybody can do this meditation. And what you do is you get, again, in a quiet place where you can be by yourself and you are just paying attention, mindful of your breathing. We call that the breath prayer. What we're doing is we're paying attention to every single breath, the in-breath, the out-breath, all the sensations, the feelings that go with that. And we add to this meditation with the in-breath or with the out-breath the words, thank you, or thanks. And that is a little prayer to God. Meister Eckhart, famous German theologian, wrote this, if the only prayer you ever say in your entire life is thank you, it will be enough. And I find that when I do this meditation, the feeling that I get of thankfulness is a wonderful emotion. And I find that paying attention to breathing is a great way to still the mind and get rid of all the thoughts and just get into that calmness. And at the same time, to feel joy in the relationship with God. So in this sermon today, we've heard a couple different examples of how learning the skill of Christian meditation can help us spiritually and in daily life. In the email that I sent out to everybody, you probably have received that. I have the scripture notes and quotes for the sermon today, and I've also listed in there, if you haven't looked at it already, the five different types of meditation that I mentioned today. And I want to ask you, at some point today, take a look at that email, read those scripture verses, and take a look at that list and see if there isn't something on that list that appeals to you that you'd be willing to try. I know that if you try it, you will be blessed by it. Amen? Let us pray. Lord God, we give thanks and praise to you that in your love and in your grace, you call us to you. You want us to grow in our knowledge of you and our love of you and our relationship with you. And so, Lord, you've made lots of different ways for us to grow in our knowledge and experience of you. But we know, Lord, that if we really want to relate to you, we have to be able to listen to you and hear when you speak. So we pray, Lord, that you would guide us to do the things that help us to quiet our minds so we can open our minds, our hearts, and our spirits to hear what you have to say to us and to experience your grace through the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. All this we pray and thank you for in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and yeah. earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever.
We've come to that time now where we share our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings with the body of Christ and with the work that is being done in mission and in ministry through this local congregation. So if you're writing out a check this morning, I encourage you to take out your checkbook and engage in that physical act of writing that check now during worship. Our address, if you're going to be mailing it, is 13400 Park Boulevard, Seminole, Florida, 33776. But we have other ways to give. You can also join in giving online, oakhurstumc.com, and click on the giving portal. There's also the giving portal link, which is listed with this video on Facebook and on YouTube. Or you can give on our app, which you can find in the iTunes store or the Google Play store under Oakhurst UMC and look for our tree logo. It's been an important season for us to continue our faithfulness of giving and stewardship and generosity towards the mission and ministry of Christ's body here at Oakhurst United Methodist Church, because your giving, your continued faithfulness has enabled us to continue to provide increased and improved content across all these ways that we are during this season to connect with individuals in our congregation and in our community. We've also been blessed by the outpouring of support that we've received for our missions ministry with our food bank, and we know that we're praying in the near future we can get back to serving people in person. As the school year starts up, we know there are going to be needs that arise that our church will want to be able to respond to, and your giving makes that possible. So we want to thank you for your continued faithfulness during this season that enables our effectiveness at ministry and mission to increase and multiply. Let's pray over what will be received today. Almighty God, we come before you now, and we thank you for all that you've given to us. We thank you for the ways in which you are calling us to join with you, to partner with you in mission and in ministry, to use our gifts in your service. And so we ask today that you bless these gifts and those who give them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Keep us from your love.
Hear now these words of benediction. As you go from this time of worship, may the Holy Spirit go with you, bless you, and keep you. May God pull gently on your heart and lift you closer to Him. Amen.
Before you go, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and share this video across all of your social media platforms. Thank you for joining us in worship. We'll see you next time.